Welcome everybody. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Coming live. I got a real good show for you guys tonight. Hope you guys don't mind me. Gotta check my my sounds and everything. Guys, I had a couple of technical difficulties last time. Everything's checking out good so far.
Subscribe now.
You guys like my choice of music. Just waiting on what's going on right now. Hopefully more people can find the channel. Everything's looking good. So how's everybody doing this weekend? I know that it's a Halloween weekend for some of you people out here. Here's a fact. My birthday is actually on Halloween, but I haven't celebrated Halloween in a long time because obviously I'm not gonna be involved in that kind of stuff, right? I'm not gonna say nothing about it. I don't advise it. I might just make a video of that one day. That makes sense. Welcome everybody. Just waiting a little bit, make sure everything's running smooth. Waiting a little bit, so make sure everything's running smooth. I got a real good one for you guys today. So I told you guys I was gonna make a video on this whole alien disclosure, and I'm going down to the root of the issue. I got a few verses for you guys, a video or two for you guys to look at. But it's interesting that we're doing this video right now because, you know, we're about 3 hours away from the celebration that a lot of people do today, right? And that's Halloween, right? Now, a lot of the stuff that I talk about, guys, it's spiritual in nature, right? A lot of it comes into this realm. I'm going to show you guys a couple of videos and a couple of things that I've come up with. But I wanted to give you guys the basis to this because I think it's important that we understand what's happening in the world around us. I'm going to put my glasses on, guys, because it's a lot of light here. It's easier when I put my glasses on, you know. It's actually, I think I told you guys it's a prescription glasses. But it gives all the light from my eyes and it doesn't irritate me as much. And I'm going to be on here for about 40 minutes today. Right, so guys, like, share, and
subscribe now. Subscribe now.
Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The show is about to begin.
So I don't want to spoil it for you guys, but we're going to get right into it. A lot of news coming out of Eastern Europe and Europe itself. So I'm not going to be talking about that today, possibly tomorrow. I'll come like tomorrow, I think. It's my birthday, so I'm just going to chill. I'm gonna hang out the whole day, and so might come by tomorrow, and I'm gonna do some research. I got a couple more videos that I'm working on, so One of the things that, like I said, the purpose of this channel is to give you guys information about things that are going to be happening very, very soon on this planet. And this, what you guys are going to hear today is going to be very, very interesting. You guys might have heard of Steve Quayle, maybe some of you. If you haven't, I'm going to show you the video right now. Now, this video that I'm about to show you guys, it talks about the Smithsonian as much as you guys have heard about the Smithsonian, right? We've discovered a lot of things about them over the last 20 years. They've been involved in a lot of cover-ups. They've been complicit with the government, you know, to cover a lot of stuff. I'm going to give you guys a little analysis of what I just said and why this great deception is happening. But let me get into it real quick, guys. Let me adjust this real quick. I had gotten an asada today, guys, so I am so full right now, and I got some fish waiting for me over there, so I love fish. I try to eat as much as I can, but this video right here, Steve Quayle talking, so let's get into it.
Steve, in your book, True Legends, you talk about a Smithsonian cover-up whenever giant bones are involved. So I want to ask you the question that everybody always asks. Where are all the giant bones?
It's interesting, Tim, because of the bias of the Smithsonian and their contempt for out-of-place artifacts. Every time giants were found, it didn't matter if it was on the West Coast, the Arctic, the Antarctic, believe it or not, the East Coast, the Ohio River mounds, they always have a fabulous cutoff point, meaning once the Smithsonian is notified and those bones are sent to the Smithsonian, they're never heard from again. And there's denials. A good example of that, it was a famous Kincaid expedition to the Grand Canyon, where they found the Egyptian citadel. Even the Phoenix Gazette carried that story. So, Tim, the cover-up has always been to keep this biblically relevant topic. Reconcile the fact that a lot of servicemen, U.S. servicemen, had been eaten, cannibalized, as well as Japanese. And the fascinating investigation I've come up with was the fact that the Solomon Islands are riddled with stories of cannibalistic giants and even living giants to this day. I was contacted by a man named Marius who was literally going to meet me in.
One of the things about this part is talking about the servicemen, you know, military men. There's a story actually that came out that in Afghanistan they were ambushed by a giant. I think it was a unit that got actually killed, and then when this special unit in Afghanistan didn't come back, they sent another special unit and they also got attacked. Now the second unit was able to overcome this giant. And they actually, there's videos of them. I didn't pull that up. I think they're going to show a picture of it right here. I'll show you guys. But this giant in the mountains of Afghanistan, because there's a lot of, it's a very mountainous area in certain parts of Afghanistan. And they actually took this giant, and then they don't know what happened with the this body, right? But that's a real story, a part of the story that's in here also. I don't think they talk too much about it right here, but they just saw a picture.
California with let's just say this irrefutable evidence. But he said to me on the phone, he said, Steve, I'm being followed and I'm not sure I'll even make it there alive. What has to be asked, the question that needs to be asked and has to be asked, is that why do people who have the evidence, why are they intimidated? Why are they threatened? Why are they disappeared? What is this cover-up? And I'll tell you the bottom line, they do not.
This is the one I'm talking about right here. This is the one that I was telling you guys about right now. These soldiers. This is the one that happened in Afghanistan, and this is what they described the giant was. I'm assuming this guy is about close to 15 feet tall. Cause just look at its knees. It's probably, but just the knee itself is somewhere around maybe 3.5 feet just from the heel all the way up to where the knee is. It if you look at this right here, this knee right here, right, this I guess you can call it a femur, right? That's what it's called. It's almost at the height of this guy. This guy's probably 6'1" right here, probably around 6. So this thing right here, right? Do you see what I'm saying right here? Like, I don't know if you guys see it. See this from the heel all the way up to the knee. If you stand that up, it's probably about the height of this guy. That guy should be around 6'1". But this thing right here is, I'm pretty sure it's no shorter than 15 feet. It's around 15 feet tall. Can you imagine something that big attacking the serviceman? Looks like a very scary looking thing, but let's continue with the video.
I not want people to understand that the sons of God, the fallen angels, saw that the daughters of earth were fair, mated with them, and produced a literally new race of hybrid beings that the Bible calls the Rephaim. And the Rephaim are with us today, their genetic trace, their genetic markers. And when we get into super soldiers, Tim, the super soldiers, the most important expenditures made are to identify not only the bloodline, but the genetic traits. There are people literally not only wanting to bring the giants back, but to insert giant genes in our soldiers to give them the super soldier.
There's something that I said multiple times on this channel already. There are certain government programs that they're doing that basically they're doing stuff like, you know, genetically engineering. Cloning's been around for a long time. I believe the cloning goes back around the 1930s from what I've seen on some reports. It goes back way long. So they've been doing this for a while. Now, one of the things that I might explain this a little bit when I go into the verses that I'm saying about why the Bible says in the New Testament that it will be like in the days of Noah. That passage says that they were marrying, drinking, eating and drinking and giving themselves away in marriages, right? People think that it's just marriage. No, there's a hidden meaning behind that, but I'll tell you guys a little bit more about that too.
More money is being spent to identify genetic traces and markers, the actual gene prints of giants, both dead and extractable DNA from their teeth, from whatever cells in the mummies, to literally living giants today.
So in other words, what you're saying is somebody's trying to weaponize giant genes.
Absolutely. And the Super Soldier program is probably one of the most almost unbelievable, yet so believable programs that the U.S. military is involved in. And all the underground labs, all the secret places around the planet, everybody's after the same thing. They want comic book heroes that we would only laugh about and have laughed about maybe for 50 years, and now it's no longer fantasy, it's fact.
And we're not just talking about superhuman strength, are we? We're also talking about superhuman cerebral capabilities that the giants had.
Absolutely. Speaking of,
think about this part, guys. Do you guys think that the DC movies, the Marvel movies, do you guys think that's really science fiction? Well, I'm gonna say something about this real quick. Those movies are coming from a place, from a fountain of where the directors. I worked in Hollywood for about, I think, 3 years or so. Right? I think three and a half years. I saw a lot of things in Hollywood. I never went to the actual parties, you know, the parties they send people for the cult. I call it the cult. I never went to the parties, but I could if I wanted to, because I had access to that. But one of the things about Hollywood is that the majority of people in Hollywood, they're occultists. They're if you become famous in Hollywood, you have to go through the gatekeepers. You have to go and do their rituals because they got to control you anyway. So when you look at these movies, those movies are not far from the truth. But a lot of these movies, these characters that we have, like Superman, I just went and saw the movie, what's the name of this movie? Black Adam, right? With The Rock that just came out. It was a really good movie. But that movie, literally, they put a demon in that movie, and they actually took a shot of hell in that movie. I wouldn't advise to go see it. I didn't think it was going to be that bad. I thought it was just a superhero movie. But when I saw it, I was like, whoa, the full hell and the devil talking and all that was going on in the movie. And I was like, whoa, this is weird. And then a demon literally comes out. I don't know what who the guy's supposed to be as a demon, but a lot of these characters, they are actually entities that are masquerading, and they're giving these ideas to these Hollywood directors. Let's go back to this, though.
Cerebral capabilities, the giants, even when they're in a stasis state, that means in suspended animation, whether it's Dr. Ernest Moldashev in Russia, in the mountains of Tibet, whether it's a whole underground base in which some of these entities, these living giants, are present, they have so much cerebral energy that they actually have what's called the red line, and you can't go past that. Or literally, they claim, according to special operations, four-star generals, that literally it causes a person to almost come apart at the seams. It not only drives people mad, but it literally just causes them to go to pieces. You understand that's the ultimate weapon. You know, Michael Crichton with Jurassic Park brought us dinosaurs, and now we're hearing about woolly mammoths being cloned, and we're hearing all these new stories that Neanderthal is no longer a member of our family tree, which I've said for 30 years. But the point being is that it's all about weapons. And as a general said to me in special operations, doesn't matter if it's ancient technology, doesn't matter if it's ancient genetics, those of us are either fighting to keep it out of the hands of the wrong people, or the wrong people are fighting us to kill us to get it into their hands. There's a war going on, and it's no longer just dusty old bones in a museum stuck away.
So, Steve, according to Genesis 6...
I'll stop it right there, guys. We'll go into that in a little bit more. What this guy was about to say, I'm gonna cut him off for a second. But he's talking about Genesis 6. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about that, and I'll let you guys know. So if once you watch this video, by the way, Steve Quayle, guys, this guy is renowned. He is known. He's been around for quite some time, and he has connections. He talked about generals here. So this is something that is known. Now, one of the things that people don't know is that the United States Armed Forces, they're the keepers of technology. We can trace back the internet itself, this internet that we have. I think the internet was given back in 1988 or 89 was when it was given access to us, right? But that internet they gave us, that internet was available back in the 1930s, right? So there's a lot that they're not telling us as far as we trace it down. I don't know that we can trace it back any further down, but excuse me, guys. So this technology is the army. The armies of the world is the one who keep. And we know about nuclear weapons, but they have far more superior weapons than nuclear weapons. But let me get into the other part of the video where I'm going to talk about this part of the subject where... let me see. So I'm gonna read this part to you. Look at what this verse right here says, right? It says, so this is Genesis 6, 1 through 2, and it says, when human beings began to increase in number on the earth, and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of humans were beautiful, and they married any of them they chose. So those giants that this is talking about, it says that let me show you guys the other verse right here real quick. So this is Numbers 13:33, right? It says, and there we saw the Nephilim, the sons of Anak, who come from the Nephilim, and we seemed to ourselves like grasshoppers, and so we seemed to them. So what is this referring to? This is talking about the land of Canaan, right? The land of Canaan is described in the book of Genesis, where God basically told the Israelites to go into this land. That was a promised land for them. I didn't pull up that this time. Maybe I'm gonna be able to pull it up. But you know what? Maybe be able to pull it up real quick. Let me show you guys right here. Let me show you guys in the map. If I can find a map right now. What shit? So let me show you guys this part right here. So the line of Canaan is basically this region right here. This region right here. This was supposed, I don't know if you guys can see what my cursor is. This was supposed to be the land of Canaan right here. This whole section right here. Israel and parts of this right here, Syria, it is supposed to be the land of Canaan, expands out this way, but right where Israel is, this is the actual promised land right here. So it extends out here too, but it's mostly this region right here. So the land of Canaan is basically where God told the Israelites to go to. So when Israel, when the Israelites left Egypt from here, right, from Egypt, they went this way, right? And then they were supposed to come conquer this area, but they stayed in the desert for 40 years and 40 nights. That's what the Bible describes. So this land right here is the one that God told them to go take, but these were the people, these were the beings that were there, right? So I'm going to show you guys another verse also. It says, there were giants in the earth in those days. And also after that, when the sons of God came into our, in, unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men which were old men of renown. So this section right here is showing us that in Genesis 6:4 is telling us who the, so who were the sons of God? The sons of God were the angels who left their, I'll show you guys that, this right here. Now I'll show you the next verse. But moving a little fast today, guys. And the angels who did not keep, watch, let me show you guys this part right here. So it says, and the angels who did not keep their position of authority, but abandoned their proper dwelling, these he has kept in darkness, bound with everlasting chains for judgment on the great day. Now, some of the giants, I mean, some of the angels, those are the ones that they call the sons of God in that verse over here. Let me see, what verse is this? Right here, it's, look, let me show. When the sons of God came unto the son, daughters of men. So these right here, this the sons of God, they are basically those angels that decided to rebel against God. And some of these angels, which the book of Enoch, I said in a previous video, go check that video, says that they came down to Mount Haran, which is right there. I think it's, I showed it last time. I won't show it right now. But these are the ones who came down, right? And they actually took some women, and from that, okay, I'll explain it like this, okay? These giants, I mean, these angels are spiritual beings. Somehow, these giants are able to take a human shape, right? They're able to take a human shape, and they, you know, made it with these women, the daughters of men. So, when that happened, the offsprings became these giants right here. Let me see. This one's right here. So the Nephilim are basically the product of those basic those angels that made it with the women. Does that make sense? So these Nephilims right here was the ones that were in the land. These ones were in this land right here, this section right here. That's, they were in there. So the Israelites went in there into the land of Canaan, and they actually conquered and killed them. And then they were able to actually take over the land and, inhabit the land. But it took God's, basically, God had to intervene and allow them to do supernaturally, because how were they going to fight these giants? You know, they were huge in that land. So the angels that left their authority or their positions, because through the cosmos, there are, I'm going to pull this up for you guys to explain that part now that I'm getting Ephesians. Let me see. I think I can spell right now. Ephesians 6, I think this is it right here. Okay, so this is the verse right here. Let me show you guys right here. So let me see if I can. So see how it says right here, for we rest, so we are not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. These creations right here is what's in the cosmos, right? Does that make sense? Let me lower this down a little bit. So Ephesians 6:12. I'm made a little closer. Maybe I can't wait. What am I doing? I'm getting better with computer, guys. So look at it again. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, right? It's not against your husband. It's not against your brother, against your mom. No, that's not who we're wrestling with, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So these beings in the cosmos, right? If you go from, leave this atmosphere, I'll call it atmosphere, up into the realm, into the, let's say where the stars and the planets are, up there, spiritually speaking, there's other dimensions. In those dimensions where the spiritual realm is. Does that make sense? So these beings are in that, in those regions. So some of the people that some, because God structured everything a specific way, right? So that's why the constellations have their own different, they move a certain way. If you look at the constellations, if you ever study astrology, not astronomy, astronomy is not, is of the devil. Astronomy, if you ever study astronomy, you see how the constellations move in unison, right? All of them. Well, within those constellations, God left authorities and left these right here, right? So, but a lot of these beings, they rebel. Some of them are angels, some of them spirits, right? And they're both the same. But some of these beings that are coming down from these areas are actually taking shape. That makes sense? And those, some of them are the ones that are coming up to our atmosphere that we see. These beings are actually real beings, right? So what's happening with that is that this is part of the great deception. Now, you guys noticed in that video also that Steve Quayle say that the Smithsonian has been keeping this secret, right? Question, why is the Smithsonian keeping this secret? And why is the Smithsonian covering this up? Well, one of the reasons why is because if giants was a thing that we will study, it validates what the Bible says, right? Second thing is this, though, is that this is part of the great deception that's here already. No, that's why the entire world has been brainwashed and indoctrinated to think about aliens, because that's something that they're most likely going to use right now in the end times. And this is one of the reasons why the governments of the world are actually, they're actually having congressional hearings to it's like investigate this stuff. They already know what's happening. You know, these generals and these people in high places like that, you know, in the army, armed forces, they already know. Did you guys know that there's about 45 levels of secrecy within the military? Do you know how far the president of the United States goes? He goes only down, I believe it's 15 levels of secrecy. After that, he's not allowed to go further. What are they hiding on the other 30 levels of secrecy? Can you imagine? I've talked to a few people that have been in the army. I have a lot of friends that went to the army. I even have family that are actually in the armed forces as well. And I hope it's not too loud, guys. My sound is showing me right now is a little bit loud. Hopefully, I'm not like overbearing with the sound right now. Give me a second if I can adjust. I'll leave it right there that way. But does that make sense? So I talked to a few people that know a thing or two. You know, I'm obviously not going to say their names on here. But you have to understand that this is a cover-up. And why are they covering up? Because this is going to be used as a part of the Great Deception. Is already here, like I already said. And also is that the Smithsonian is doing two things. I don't know if you guys heard this before, that there is no actual evidence that dinosaurs even existed. I don't know if you guys heard about this before. Now, all the bones you see that are put out, if you didn't look this up, the bones that are being putting out at the museums, they're not actual bones. They're actual replicas of these bones, right, of dinosaurs. Now, I cannot fully disqualify a dinosaur type of animal, because in the book of Job, it talks about a giant type of mammal that was here. I don't know if I'll be able to pull it up right now. Let me double check that real quick, right? So what's happening here is that, let me see if I might be able to pull it up. Let me see if I can find it here real quick. I might be able to find it. Give me a second. Oh, let me see. I think I found it. Let me see if I found it, guys. Okay, I think I found it actually. Oh, I'm pretty good. Let me see if I found it. I'll show you guys right here. Look. So look at what it describes here in the book of Job 40, a behemoth. It says, "Behold now, behemoth, which I made with thee. He eateth." This is the old English. Let me see if I can actually read this. "He eateth grass as an ox. Lo now, he strengtheneth his loins, and his forces in the navel of his belly." Wow, this is, I feel illiterate right now when I'm reading this. "He moveth his tail like a cedar. The sinews of his stones are wrapped together. His bones are as strong pieces of brass. His bones are like bars of iron. He is the chief of the ways of God. He that made him can make his sword to approach unto him. Surely the mountains bring him forth food where all the beasts of the fields play. He lieth under the shady trees in the cover of the reed and fence. The shady trees cover him with their shadow. The willows of the brook compass him about. Behold, the drink before he drinketh up a river, and it hath not the trust that he can draw up Jordan into his mouth. He taketh it with his eyes, his nose piercings through snare." Wow, that was horrible. That was bad. It's like such a tongue twister. So this creature right here is describing a creature that God made, right? Now it's a big thing. Whatever this is huge. Now, is this evidence of dinosaurs? I wouldn't say necessarily it's evidence of dinosaurs. It's evidence that there have been some big creatures on this planet. But I can't really say this is a dinosaur. It's a big thing, right? Now, dinosaurs themselves, there's no actual real evidence that they ever existed. But let me tell you why that is. The education system and science puts dinosaurs in. You want to know why? It's a distraction, right? Now, I'm not going to fully discount them because of this versus this part right here. I wouldn't be an educated person if I straight out, you know, dismissed it, one or multiple. But this is here, so I cannot fully dismiss it. But the only way that the theory of evolution can pass, right, is because of the reason why the theory of evolution can be validated to the scientific community, right, is because if they have dinosaurs is the link, right? The dinosaurs are the link in throughout evolution, and that's how they can explain away, you know, that there's such thing as evolution. Now, I'm not going to get into the the idea of evolution because it's a very deep subject, and I don't have the time tonight. But let's just say that evolution is impossible as far as we can go in relationship to a type of evolution is mutation. That's where it finishes, right? You know what mutation is? A mutation is when the cell in an organism, right, begins to try to evolve, and that's what causes cancer, basically, right? So the mutation of the cell is what cancer is. So the reason why we cannot evolve is because the moment that a species try to cross to another species, it kills itself, basically. So evolution in itself, that disqualifies evolution. And scientists have known this for a long time. But can you imagine how deep the deception goes in the academia, where they don't want to accept this. They don't want to say this. Ask any scientist who actually understands science, and that's true. Evolution stops at mutation, which is cancer, and cancer in any species. Now, are there variances in species? Yeah, there's variances in species, just like the human race, right? We have all types of colors. So yes, there is variances. But there are certain animals who mutate, right, that have a type of mutation that could be said to be evolution. Like I said, this is a deep subject, but there are certain species, and most of them are in the ocean. Most of these creatures are actually in the ocean. So the ones that we've seen, and they're at the bottom of the ocean, most of them. Anyway, I'm going to get away from that subject because I wasn't prepared to bring that up. I have to show you guys evidence of that stuff. So let me show you guys right here. So I think they went through all of them. I think I showed you guys all of these already. Okay, so this part right here, look. So those giants came. So it says the other part. So, and they bare children to them. The same became mighty men, which were of all men of renown. So these angels that came, right, and they left their positions, right? These came and they made it with the daughters of man, and they created these giants. This is where the root of all of this is, right? But another thing is this, though, is that that's one of the reasons why that book of Ephesians, what I showed, there's a fight going on in the cosmos. There's constantly a fight up there because is the dark world against the light world. And those two worlds are fighting up there, and that stuff trickles onto this planet. And it shows in politics and other parts of, for example, this whole thing with Halloween. That stuff that is there's forces of evil that are actually manifesting themselves down here. I'm not going to go too much more into that, but as you guys can see, there's so much more to this. So the Great Deception is a part of this. The Great Deception that was in Jesus' time. It didn't start like 500 years ago or 700 years ago. This started around Jesus' time. That's what I'm saying. So as you know, as Christians, one of the things that you need to be aware of is that these beings most likely are going to come down to this planet again. They're already embedding themselves within governments. We know this already. And that's one of the things that you're going to have to like decide for yourself one day, that you got to prepare yourself. Oh, this is the one that I was going to show you. I just remember why I'm saying that. Let me pull up that verse so you guys can look at it. Galatians, I think it's, I can't remember the... Let me see if this is it. Galatians. Let me see. Okay, I'm going to show you this right here. Why I'm making all of these videos. Look at what this says right here. Look at what that part says right here. If you guys can, let me see if I can actually make that bigger too. Okay. Now, if you want to know why I'm making these videos, look at what it says right here. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let them be under God's curse. Did you see that? What that said? This right here is implying or telling us that there's a big probability that these beings are going to come down again in some fashion, and they're going to present the world to themselves to the world right before the rapture. That's what we were seeing here. But it says, but even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let them be cursed. Now, I'm going to say something real quick about this verse. When I was about 11 or 12 years old, right, we became Mormons. This is not a dish at Mormons. I'm not trying to talk bad about Mormons. We were Mormons. We went to a church. We got baptized. And one day, a lady that's a pastor, came to my house with her husband. And we started to talk about the Bible because I was already questioning the Mormon church, right, and their doctrine. So she showed me this verse right here. And remember that in the Book of Mormon, Joseph Smith says that an angel came to him and showed him the plates where the Book of Mormon was written on. He took him to the forest, and under a rock, he found these tablets. where the Book of Mormon was inscribed. And he said, an angel. Go look at the Book of Mormon. So when she read to me, I was like, oh, an angel, right? So I was like, this is how I basically went from becoming a Mormon to, you know, coming to Christ when I was about, I think, 11 or 12. I might have been 11 because I started going to church when I was 12. But if you look at this right here, it says that if an angel, Why are they warning us that there's possibly an angel that can come down? Because these beings are going to deceive people. So if people borrow themselves to this new age thinking, the manifestation ideals, concepts that are coming out in the world, what do you guys think we have so much of that today? Manifesting this, manifesting that, right? Or, you know, manifestation or the power manifestation, that is rampant all throughout the internet if you guys want to see it. All of that is demonic and satanic in nature. So if you're into that, if you're a Christian, my advice to you is go to God, pray, repent, and stop doing that. Because it's not good. You're offending God, and the Bible says that we're not supposed to be looking into the stars with astronomy, right? Astronomy, yeah. Astronomy is a bad one, right? I always get confused with the two. But astronomy is bad. We're not supposed to be looking at all the other constellations and looking at this stuff to look into our future. And that's one of the things that a lot of people in the church are having a lot of issues with. Anyway, I'm gonna make another video and more about not at some of this, but a little bit more about more into the evidence of the UFO phenomena. But this is the footprint. The first video in this video is the footprint for that, for you guys to look at where the origins are coming from, and everything that's gonna happen pretty soon, because it's moving very fast. 2017 was a big year for this, and that's when they set up the organizations to investigate all of this. So there's a lot coming, right? So anyway, guys,
this session is adjourned.